Well, howdy guys and gals. Welcome back to the Social Regressive and part two of our massive optics series talking about how to select the perfect rifle scope for you and what you plan to do with it. We have a lot of first-time buyers out there, so I figured this would be a good time to go through some of the jargon that we're going to be using in all the videos in this series. This is going to be about a 14 to 15 part series, and I want to make sure that everybody understands what I'm talking about when we go through some of this stuff. Okay, so first off, we're going to talk about the parts of a rifle scope. So probably one of the biggest things you're going to hear me talk about is the objective. That is the first lens. That's the one that first collects light here on this end. It's usually the largest lens that we have in a scope. Kind of depends on what we're dealing with. You'll see some other examples over here. But yeah, this is the objective bell and the objective lens sitting in the objective bell. On the opposite end, you have the ocular bell and the ocular lens. So this is the one closest to your eye to get the correct focus for your individual eye, because not all of our eyes work the same way. Some of us may have prescription lenses that we have to wear, either contacts or glasses. And if you want to be able to see correctly through your scope, you're going to want to probably twist this diopter adjustment at the end of the scope. This is what we call a fast focus, either diopter or eyepiece, as we're going to call this, so I can get my correct focus. We have some other types. Like this one. This is more of your traditional hunting scope. A lot of you guys will have this, where it's kind of a couple different parts. In order to adjust your diopter for your eye, you're actually going to spin the whole eyepiece. And then you're going to have perhaps a locking ring right here that's going to lock it into place. We have some other systems as well. Some of the more modern scopes will actually have kind of a fast focus with a lock. Like the Bushnell XRS2 killer scope. That thing is awesome. But you're going to see a couple different ways to get the same effect. Now, next up from there, you're going to have your zoom ring. And in this case, we do have a little throw lever attached. Most of these is just going to be a ring that has some knurling on it. It's with a K. But you grab that and you can spin that to be able to change your magnification. We'll talk about that term here in a second. It's more of a concept one. But yeah, that's how you change from, on this one, a 4.5 up to 18x. In front of that, we're going to have the tube. This is going to come in all kinds of sizes. This is a 1-incher. Some of the scopes you see here are 30 millimeter, and then stepping up to 34 millimeter, there are 35 and 40. And that tube is going to determine some pretty interesting things. We'll talk about that in another video. But it's going to be the same here at the back as it is here on the front, and that's where you attach your rings. Up here, we're going to have the turrets. So this is how you're going to adjust your elevation. So if I click this around, usually if we're looking from the top, if I click it anti-clockwise, counterclockwise, that's going to dial me up for some of the longer shots, go the other way for some of the shorter shots, or if I need to adjust my zero. This is your windage knob right here. So yeah, it's elevation up top. That's going to be how much drop you need to deal with, or your change in vertical. To change your horizontal, this is the windage knob. These are called exposed turrets right here, so I can just reach up and grab them. We also have some that are capped. So this guy right here, the Mueller, that has caps. I'll need to spin these off to get at the turrets underneath. And some of these are going to be, let me find a good example. Some of these will be very easy to grab and turn. Some of these you may need a coin. Some of the older hunting scopes especially, they tried to keep everything really, really low profile, very small and snag free. And so in order to turn these, there's really nothing to grab with your fingers. You have to use a coin or maybe the rim of a cartridge to kind of slot in there and click this around. So this is definitely more of your old school scope. Actually, this is an old scope. This is an old Simmons gold metal pistol scope. Really, really good one. On the side here, we may have some options for what is attached to what is going to be your left side of the scope, usually. In this case, we have parallax adjustment. And this is going to kind of do two things. It's going to bring the target into focus. So if I have two different targets, one at 50 yards and then one at 500 yards, if I have a higher magnification scope like this one, they're not going to both be in focus. So I can roll this to address one or the other. But this is actually more important than that, and we're going to talk about this in another video. Parallax is a bit more than just getting the correct focus. If we are off on our focal planes in here, if they are not all lined up, not only will we not see the object of our desire in focus, but actually our reticle can move around relative to it, and we may actually miss our shot entirely. It tries to line up both things. If everything is set up really well inside the scope and you get everything dialed in correctly, you should not only get correct focus on your target, but you should also get that parallax fixed so that if your eye is off just a little bit to one side or the other, you're not going to miss your shot, and they both should track together, but they might not. I can't say that they necessarily will. So one thing that you might want to do is when you go to take that shot, move your eye around a little bit, and if you see the crosshair moving relative to the target, fix your parallax, even if the focus isn't quite right. There's another way to address that focus or parallax, and that's what's called an adjustable objective right up front here. This one doesn't have side adjust. This one is up front, and so I can just grab this whole bell and twist it to get my correct parallax. And you can see that this has an estimate of what kind of yardage. This one goes from 15 yards all the way up to infinity. All of them will go to infinity, but it's how close is gonna be some of the more interesting things to talk about when we get into that particular discussion. Now that left side knob might not be parallax adjustment. It might be illumination, or it might be a combination of both. This right here is a US Optics TS-20X, really nice scope. This has a big tube, as you can see. This is a 34 millimeter tube. This one can do a whole lot. This is a very, very flexible and powerful scope. But this has parallax adjustment here on the side, so I can twist this kind of inner ring, and then this outer one is illumination. So I actually have an illuminated reticle on the inside, and if I twist this around, it'll actually light up the reticle on the inside. Those are going to be your main parts and controls, but then we do also have some other jargon that we're going to be getting into. In this next video that we're going to do, we're going to be talking about magnification and zoom ratio. Magnification is the ability of anything from a camera lens to a rifle scope like this one to increase the apparent size of whatever it is that you're looking at. So we have some here that will go all the way down from 1x, for example, so it'll see things the same way that your eye does, but then it might zoom all the way up to, say, 4x, so you can see your target four times larger than it normally would be to your eye. Zoom ratio is what the ratio is between your low end and your high end. So if we have a scope like, oh, this one right here, this is the Falcon S8i, and this has a zoom ratio of 8x. This is a huge zoom ratio and very uncommon in the industry. This will go all the way from 1x, so I'm seeing the same magnification through the scope as I am with my normal eye. And then if I zoom this all the way up to 8x, that's going to be increasing it quite a bit. I'm going to see the target much larger, eight times larger than what I just did. So that is a zoom ratio of 8x on that one. It's much more common to have 3x, like a 3-9 scope. Your average whitetail scope is going to have a 3x zoom ratio. You're going to see 4, like you get a lot of these AR style scopes, like this one, the LPVOs. A lot of these are going to be 1-4. This is a 1-8 right here, so this is another 8x zoom ratio. We're going to talk about those numbers in another video and what they really mean in the real world. It might sound like more is better, but that's not necessarily so. So we're going to kind of delve into that and talk about when you might want to pick one over the other. One last thing that we're going to be talking about a whole lot is something that is not apparent from the outside of the scope. You can only see it by looking through. That is the reticle. The reticle is that series of lines. It could be the traditional crosshair like you normally see in a whitetail hunting scope. It could be a mil dot reticle. It could be one of those bullet drop compensating, or my personal favorite, the Horus Tremor 3. There are all kinds of reticles out there that all do different things, and I'm gonna help you try to figure out which one might work for you and what you plan to do. And that's what this whole series is about. We're gonna talk about where that reticle is placed, what reticle might work best for your situation and the way that your own mind thinks, And yeah, we have a whole lot to talk about, so do not miss a thing. We are going to have a full, huge series on this, so make sure that you like, share, subscribe, and hit that notification bell down below so you can be notified when the next video comes out. You're not going to want to miss a thing. This is something that you are going to want to share with other folks too, especially if they start having some questions about, you know, what kind of scope do I want for my rifle? Hopefully this series is going to answer a lot of those questions. Thanks a lot for watching, and special thanks to patrons of the Destructive Arts that keep the lights on and keep me in good audio gear and cameras so that we can get this message out to more people. YouTube doesn't like us, but apparently some other people do. So thanks a lot to the 338 Lapua Magnum patrons. We have Sportsman's Guide, Stan and Mary, and we have Tyler. And then at the 300 Win Mag level, we have Joseph Davis, Peter, Mr. No Name, and Howard. Thanks a lot, you guys, and to everybody else that's chipping in a buck or two a month. I think that a lot of people are going to get a lot of use out of this particular series, and you guys are making it possible. See you all in the next video. Thanks for watching. If you liked this video, be sure to like, share, and most importantly, subscribe. Even if you didn't like this particular content, go ahead and subscribe. There's probably something coming that's more up your alley. Check out this playlist right here. This is going to have videos in a similar vein to what you just watched. These two videos we cherry-picked for you. And finally, The Social Regressive is on Patreon. So, you can become a patron of the Destructive Arts and earn some goodies while helping us to provide high-quality videos just by kicking us a few bucks a month. Thanks a bunch for your patronage.